Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the 40th meeting of the Economy Committee. Some members will be attending the meeting this morning via video conference, and our witnesses today will be briefing us via video conference. The meeting will be broadcast live on a recording will be made available on the committee's web pages on the Assembly website. And just to remind members to mute their devices by pushing F4, please. So moving on then to item number one, which is the apologies. We have no apologies, but we're expecting John Stewart a little bit.
Yeah, later. Chair, okay. Thanks, yeah.
Item number two then is our draft minutes, which is 2.1 in your packs. There was a copy of draft minutes at page 4 of the meeting held on the 4th of November, of the 11th of November. So are members content that these are an accurate reflection of the meeting?
Great.
Thank you. So moving on then to item number three, which is Chair's Business. At page 12 of your pack, there's a clerk's memo regarding the informal meeting on the 12th of November with the Law Society in relation to mediation services. We had agreed to hold an informal meeting with them about the mediation services following a written request from the Society. So the briefing notes there, it was quite a useful briefing. Is there anyone you want to add to that, Peter?
Chair, no, it was just, it was fairly expansive, and the discussion opened up the idea of potentially looking at mediation services being applied more often to commercial disputes, particularly in the area of public procurement, where often it ends up in a court and you have to rerun a tender at significant cost and delay. Whereas if you wrote in potentially a clause around mediation being part of the deal, you might not have to end up in court. You might save a lot of time and money. So it's certainly an issue worth pursuing, and something probably I think we would want to look at if we were getting a suitable legislative vehicle coming through from the Minister, which I think probably will be at the start of the next year or early spring. We'll probably have something come through. So it might be a case of beginning to talk to the Department about how they might apply this.
So are members content then with that? Are there any comments or suggestions? Okay. If members are content, we're going to move into closed session by moving to item number 16 on our agenda, which is a special report on the committee's micro inquiry into the macroeconomic picture.
So if you just want to press the button, Chair.
Great.
This is the Northern Ireland.
Okay, members, so we're back into open session and we're moving on to item number 4 on the agenda, which is matters arising. So first of all, 4.1 at page 18 of your packs is a response from the Minister in relation to petroleum licensing. The committee agreed to forward correspondence from Safety Before LNG to the Minister for comment. The Minister has stated the Department had similar correspondence from another source which contained many of the same or similar allegations against the Department and officials. The Department's Director of Corporate Governance is currently undertaking an investigation into these allegations, and it would not be appropriate for the Minister to make any further comments at this stage. However, the Minister will provide the committee with a further update when the investigation has concluded. If we just then move on to point 4.14, which is at page 5 of your table pack, which is a response from the Minister in regards to the DfE abuse of petroleum licensing process. This correspondence indicates that an investigation has concluded and no issues were raised around the concerns highlighted to the committee. So if members have any comments that they want to make on this at this point?
No? Chair, where that leaves us is we've essentially let the Department know everything that we know. The Department has concluded its investigation, doesn't find the allegations, and I suppose now we'll proceed with the process of assessing the application. So that's kind of where we are. And it might be the committee wants to think about whether we wait to see what happens with that before going any further.
Great.
Members are content?
Yep.
Great.
Thank you.
So 4.2 then, at page 19 of your packs, there's a response from the Minister in relation to issues raised by LUMP. The member, so I assume that
will fall under that as well,
under
Chair.
The same category as the previous. The committee did have an informal meeting with the representatives of LAMP on the 15th of October and discussed their issues and concerns. So unless there's anything further that members want to add. So moving on then to 4.3 at page 23 of your packs, there's a response from the Minister in relation to higher education COVID issues, and the committee had agreed to correspond with the Minister in regards to a range of higher education issues flowing from informal meetings the committee has undertaken. The Minister has stated that the department has worked with other relevant departments and agencies to address guidance for students, all of which has now been published on NI Direct. On the issue of advice on weekend and between term travel, the Minister has said the department is not in a position to develop advice unilaterally. They are not public health experts. However, the Public Health Agency has now published specific advice for students, and which advises that students should avoid any travel home if possible. The Minister has stated that higher education institutes are autonomous bodies, so therefore they are responsible for their own policies and procedures in relation to mental health provision.
Just on that.
Chair, the Deputy Chair wants to come in as well.
I think it is a very detailed response from the Minister. However, I do think it would be worth maybe having further conversations with the institutions. Declare an interest. I have a niece who's in her first year at Queen's. And I can say the student experience has just been non-existent. And when, you know, people aren't doing this for free in terms of their university education, I think it might be worth having conversations with the universities and in terms of just how they're actually delivering their courses and where they think there's room for improvement going forward, particularly if the intention is that these sorts of restrictions are to continue until March. If you're into March, you know, that's nearly an entire academic year shot. So I think it would be worth initiating a further conversation at committee level with Queen's UU, OU less so because of the nature of how they deliver their learning. But I think it would be worth having conversations.
And the FE colleges.
And the FE colleges as well.
Chair, we have...
Okay. To come in. Yep, sure. And just to also say in relation to the response, the Minister has also outlined the measures that are in place to assist students experiencing financial hardship and has noted that executive colleagues hold a weekly COVID enforcement meeting and that the higher education was previously featured on the agenda. Department officials have also asked the Executive Office to ensure that should higher education feature again on the enforcement group's agenda, that NUS, GSI are invited to those meetings.
Yeah.
And that is something that the committee has obviously pressed for as well. So Sinead wants to come in.
Yeah, thank you very much, Chair. And I just want to make comment myself, John Dowd, and Stuart attended a student deserves better campaign launch by NUS and USI last night, and it was really heart-wrenching. We had six presentations from the students, and their stories were extremely sad, to be honest with you. They've had an awful experience, and students are not a straightforward, you know, they're not all 18, 19-year-olds. I mean, these were mature students. Some of them owned their own homes. Some of them had children, families, etc. And they are in dire financial straits. So there's lots of problems. There's lots of problems around their accommodation. There are lots of problems around, you know, whether they can travel back home, etc., etc. And I really don't think that they have been well supported in relation, you know, within the context of the universities themselves, but also they haven't really been given clear direction by government either. They're really pushed from pillar to post, and there's a lot of washing the hands off. It's not our problem, but it is somebody's problem, and I think, you know, there needs to be a more strategic approach in how we support our student communities. We're almost 2 months, well, January, I suppose, towards the middle of January, that they will get into their second semester, and there's still no clear direction of how they will be delivered their education programmes, and how they are going to be, you know, are they going to be working from home? Are they going to be learning from home? And what impact does that have in
their accommodation, particularly those that are, have signed contracts within the private sector. I really think that, you know, we as a committee, once we've heard that plea and outcry, that we should maybe, you know, be a little bit proactive here, perhaps get together with the chairs of the health committee, the chairs of the communities committee, and see what we can do collectively with the ministers in those areas so that we can have a support mechanism for those students. There really are mental health issues around all of this as well. And I felt really as if we had let them down after hearing their dire stories yesterday evening. And as I say, Stuart and John were joined in that Zoom yesterday, and they will testify, I'm sure, their uncomfortableness with the stories that are actually happening within the wider student community. And I feel that there's an onus on us now that we've heard that we can't ignore it.
Sinead, and I suppose just to add, I did check out the guidance that's on the PHA website, and it's a bit minimalist in terms of what it's suggesting. It's basically saying don't travel home, and that's about the height of it. Sorry, John O'Dowd wanted to come in as well.
Yeah, thank you, Chair. And yes, as Sinead has said, at the event staged last night by the Students' Union, the accounts were quite harrowing on the hardships our students are facing. And again, it's worth pointing out, as Sinead said, we're not just talking about the image of young, single people who are students. We're talking a slice of life here in terms of the age range and the backgrounds of people who are studying in our universities and colleges and who are facing the consequences of the COVID-19 outbreak and the hardship that's bringing. I do, and I am concerned that the executive or the minister's letter refers to the executive dealing with students' issues through the enforcement subcommittee. This is not an enforcement issue, it's a curing issue. And the enforcement issue comes about from events in the Holy Lands, which involve some students and other members of the public of a variety of age ranges. So I don't think we should allow the student issue to be dealt with as an enforcement issue. It's the wrong setting for it. And as I said, it has to be a curing and support issue moving forward. One of the issues I did raise last night, and I think I raised this at last week's committee, maybe we're waiting on a response to it, is access to the hardship fund, the student hardship fund. There is about £4 million left in the student hardship fund. At the height of the crisis, it was sitting around maybe £6 million. But students were telling us last night, and these are mature students, were telling us last night, that it's, the application process takes about 2 months to be successful. And then you have to sit through a video which tells you about the budget and where to shop for cheap food, which I think is disgraceful. Cheap food is not good food. And mature adults who are running a family home, bringing up children, don't need to be shown a video on how to budget for money. If they want to show videos, show them a video of where they can secure more money to see them through their lives. So perhaps, and if I didn't raise it last week, I apologise, but I would like more information on the student hardship funds, how they're run and how they can be expanded. Because if there's £4 million sitting there, and that has to be spent by March of next year, that £4 million would be better off in students' pockets, allowing them some leeway or leverage in terms in dealing with the huge financial pressures they are facing. Thank you.
Thanks, John. And on that specific issue of student hardship, it's one I have raised with the Minister previously in relation to the eligibility criteria of the hardship fund. And she had indicated that she was content that the criteria were appropriate in terms of directing that support to students who most need it. I think perhaps those criteria are appropriate under normal circumstances, but these aren't normal circumstances. And that we should be looking again at those eligibility criteria to ensure that that money is getting out quickly to students. And if there is another delivery mechanism that's needed to get that money out, then that's something that also needs to be addressed. Gary, you were looking to come in.
Yeah, thanks, Chair. I unfortunately couldn't attend the engagement last night, although I did get an invite to it, and I passed on my apologies. Unfortunately, we were in Parliament Buildings for another significant piece of business until early hours of this morning, but I did pass on my apologies. And also, I've been engaging with the students on the APG, on Further and Higher Education, which is, of course, just newly established, and I've been elected as vice chair of that grouping. So I've heard from some of the students, and like them, and like all of the MLAs around the table, no doubt, we are concerned. I think that we do need a very clear strategy in relation to these issues. I think there needs to be a cross-departmental approach. One of the suggestions that I was going to make was around the health piece, maybe the guidance in terms of as we go on to the second semester, that could we maybe write to the health minister, could we engage with the health committee and try and bring people together to get some sort of clarity. And I know this is a difficult time for everyone, but we need to bring that clarity about. So I think that as a committee, we do need to maybe do a bit more in that respect as well.
Thanks, Gary. Stuart?
Yeah, Chair, I did attend that meeting last night and agree with my colleagues that the stories were very difficult. I'm not sure that the Minister can entirely wash her hands of it just in this correspondence. I think also the universities and colleges have questions to answer. This is not about apportioning blame at this stage, but when you hear comments like the promises that were made by the universities to bring us to university to do our courses, and then how very quickly everything that was promised changed to online, and setting aside the issue of the Holy Land, which actually, in the grand scheme of things, while it was incredibly annoying at the time, is in reality only a tiny part of a very serious, much more serious issue. The much more serious issue are those things that people have made reference to. It's the health and mental well-being of students. If you're told that your course is going to go ahead and that it will be delivered through live lectures, socially distant and all of that, and then all of a sudden massive changes take place, everything starts to be online. Those things are very distressing for people, whether they're teenagers or whether they are older people attempting to either move to higher degrees or indeed coming into education at that stage at a higher level. I also agree with Gary that we very seriously need to look at how the universities and colleges are going to address the second semester. To just allow this to drag on and continue is unacceptable. And I really do think, Chair, that we need to bring all of the key stakeholders together. This isn't about apportioning blame. It is actually about trying to deliver some sort of quality of education and learning into the second semester. And I do somewhat despair that it seems to have passed over the heads of those that are currently, I'm sure they're working very hard in their delivery, but is it actually working? And if it's not, then they need to readdress how they're going to do that. Universities have a big obligation to people who they said come to Belfast and have committed themselves to accommodation. It goes into the whole area around the hardship fund and all of that. So I really do think that we need to take some action this side of Christmas.
No, I agree with that. And I think if we do look at, perhaps, Peter, at getting the chairs of the appropriate committees together, if you would correspond with the
Yes, Chair, I imagine it would be sorted as quick as we can.
TEO Health and Communities and yeah. ourselves. And if we can maybe try and get that set up early next week, and we can then decide how we want to take that forward, as you say, Stuart, with a kind of cross-departmental and inter-institutional approach to it.
Yeah.
And just to put on record our thanks to the student representatives who have continued to keep this issue on the agenda and have been very effective in their highlighting of all of the issues. And at last night's meeting, I also passed on my apologies as I was involved in another meeting. But I have engaged with the student unions and on previous occasions and know from testimonies how difficult the circumstances currently are for young people and people of all ages that are in higher education. So if we action that, Peter, that would be...
Absolutely, we'll get that sorted as quickly as possible.
Thank you. Okay, so moving on then to 4.4. At page 29 of your packs, there's a response to the Minister in relation to correspondence from the committee regarding a dispute between the college's employers forum and the trade union side on lecturers' pay and conditions of service. The Minister agrees with the committee members that this dispute needs to be brought to a successful conclusion as soon as possible, and it's understood both parties have now agreed a date to meet. Do members have any further comments they want to make at this point?
Happy to note.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
4.5 then, at page 30 of your packs, there's a written statement from the Finance Minister in relation to the 2020-21 October monitoring round and COVID funding. Unless members have any comments they wish to make for noting. I think we did that last week.
We did, it's just the Finance Committee resent it. Oh. So we put it in the packet.
Thank you.
Chair, is again this an opportunity for us to inquire of our department, because the department has been, I think, rightly criticised for handing funds back at the end of the financial year and at various stages through the year, but granted that that funding might be particularly ring-fenced for a specific project. But I think as we fast approach the end of the financial year, we should again set down a marker with the department and see just exactly where the areas of risk are. I don't want them to squander funds, but I want to make sure that money which was bid for is actually being properly utilised, and that we minimise the amount of return.
Yeah, no.
Chair, that's part of the process we're engaged in. The department members will recall that the officials themselves have said on many occasions they're very alive to wanting to be able to get the money that they're being allocated spent. And the process does need to be directed towards making sure that can happen. The end of the financial year is not far away, and there is still a significant amount of money, both at the centre, and potentially having to be reworked within the department. COVID has lasted longer and been much more complex than anyone imagined.
I absolutely agree that it's important that the money has got out the door. By the same token, if it's got out the door too quickly or in the wrong way, when the inevitable audit office investigation comes along, ministers will end up being strung up from a lamppost for how they behaved. So I think it is important that there's a balance, because I think the National Audit Office have started already, and ministers in London are already under serious pressure because of decisions that they made. So, but yes, I absolutely agree. We need to get the money out the door as quickly as possible.
And I know in the October monitoring round, didn't some money go back in relation to the tourism?
Yeah.
Yes, they couldn't spend it quickly enough because of the issues at the time not being able to be open. And
that,
so
that is something, obviously, that we just need to keep.
The other thing, Chair, was the Minister's made the point that she has bids in for meeting the requirements of those that have not been successful in getting funding. So we're looking forward to progress on that, and hopefully that will happen soon.
Tomorrow, she said.
Yeah, for the self-employed.
Yeah,
yeah, but another other bids in.
Okay, so then moving on to 4.6 at page 59 of your packs. There's a DfE report on the financial impact of the 4-week circuit breaker, which we had asked for last week. And the department stated that at the height of spring lockdown, the output in the economy was operating around 25% below normal levels, where the pre-pandemic economy was worth around $42 billion in terms of GVA per annum. It's estimated that approximately $5 billion of output could be lost during 2020. In addition, around 250,000 employments availed of the job retention scheme and over 70,000 claimed from the self-employed income support scheme. These figures are cumulative, but figures from the latest HMRC release show that many employments were unfurloughed over the summer as the executive reopened the local economy. The department has undertaken an initial assessment of the economic impact of the 4-week circuit breaker, and they consider that the measure is likely to impact with the possible loss of £400 million to the economy and a direct impact of the circuit breaker on around 60,000 jobs. And obviously there were some caveats in the paper in relation to the figures. So unless members have any comments they wish to make. Sorry, go ahead, Christopher.
Yes, Chair, thank you. I think it's really important that those figures are out there and are understood by people, because I think for the last while, the prevailing narrative has been, you know, that this is essentially, it's almost as though this doesn't have an impact, but £400 million over 4 weeks, that's £100 million a week. For every week that we lock down the economy, £100 million less in the economy of Northern Ireland. And I think, you know, it just underscores the need to get, as in my view, and I know others may disagree with me, although I hope not on the Economy Committee, but it just underscores the need to get as much of the economy as open, as safely as possible, as quickly as possible, because we can't sustain this as a society. And I think it's really important that those figures are there, because there's other sets of figures being bandied around, our numbers, etc. But, you know, it's important to have these figures as well to just demonstrate the calculations and the quandary that ministers find themselves in terms of having to balance one off against the other.
Chair, I don't disagree with what Christopher's saying, but I think it's also about protecting our workforce. And it's not just about protecting them in the short term from pandemic, but if you look at the damage that is being done in relation to mental health, if you look at the damage in relation to what's clearly going to be with us for a long time into the future, the whole issue around long COVID, to expose the workforce to the illness in itself causes very serious problems, and therefore there is a balance to be struck between the short-term pain of restricting our economy and the longer-term gain of where we go once, hopefully, vaccines and other issues kick in. I don't underestimate the damaging effect to our economy, but equally well, we must take into account the damaging effect on individuals as well.
John O'Dowd.
Thank you, Chair. The debate about the economy v health are running in tandem, obviously has vexed us all for a considerable period of time, and indeed other societies as well are tackling with this issue. I think the report from the department is useful, but like all facts and figures that we've been given over this last period of time, it deserves to be drilled down into and examined very closely, just to discuss the preparation of those figures and the research into those figures. And I haven't done that in great detail, so I'm not contesting the figures in any way, but it has to be closely examined. I think the issue, the operative word in all of these conversations is safe. And and who wouldn't want the economy open up again? Who wouldn't want society open up again? But it has to be done in a safe manner, because I think there's obviously the health damage that will be delivered and the outcomes of that, but also long-term damage to our economy as well in terms of the costs of dealing with the health impact of COVID over perhaps a generation when you look at long COVID moving forward. So like all facts and figures, it deserves to be examined. I have been speaking to businesses, as we all have, over this last number of weeks, months, since COVID has hit us. And there's another narrative out there as well in this last number of weeks. I've been speaking to people in the hospitality sector who were prepared to close for another 2, 3, 4 weeks for a variety of reasons. One of them was support the health message. But also anybody who's any background in hospitality will know that November is the worst month of the year, perhaps followed by January. And what businesses were saying to me, they were saying, John, if you give us the money, if you get that money you promised us out the door, we can stay closed for a couple of weeks. We'll take the hit. But what we need is money. So it goes back to the previous conversation about support schemes and all those things. Businesses are prepared to play their part in tackling COVID. But what they're saying quite firmly is, give us the money to stay closed. Don't promise us money. Give us the money to stay closed and we'll play our part. And so that's, to me, is the crux to all this. If we're going to close businesses, and if we have to close businesses, we have to give them the money.
then Claire.
Gary, going ahead.
Thanks, Chair. Obviously, the report does make for some very depressing and very stark reading. We know that those 4 week restrictions talks about, you know, having a significant impact of £400 million in the economy, affecting 60,000 individuals. That's something that should really worry us all in this economy committee. Rightly so, we should be worried about health. We should be worried about education. But as an economy committee, our focus is on the economy. I have to say, through my own constituency office, day in, daily, we're seeing an increase in the number of people coming and asking for food parcels and access to food vouchers. We know, like, single mothers, for example, coming forward and, you know, seeking advice around where can they get finance, payday loans. This is a really deeply concerning situation. And the mental health impact alone on someone losing their job or the threat of losing their job is something not worth thinking about. So we need to take all of this in the round. Let's open up the economy safely, do it with the proper guidance, and do it with a personal responsibility as well. You know, we can shut down the economy, but if people do not even take personal responsibility, that's not going to have any impact. When we reopen the economy, the personal responsibility piece is still going to be there. And I would just urge everyone to please bear that in mind. Those figures that we've seen in this report, that was for 4 weeks. Don't forget, in my constituency, we've had 6 weeks of this. You know, we're going to now see another week from Friday for those hospitality industries as well. So the impact of this is so severe. We're going to be dealing with it for many years to come. So we need to take all of this in the round and try and bring about a situation where we can open our economy safely alongside the health advice.
Thanks, Claire. And just to remind members that NICVA are coming in at 11, so we might have to stop after this item. But go ahead, Claire.
Sorry, beg your pardon, Chair, I couldn't unmute there for some reason. No, thank you and good morning, everyone. You know, like, I agree with all the comments, and I think it's what has become very clear to me, certainly from a constituency perspective, is that opinion on this is very polarised. You know, equally, I'm getting as many constituents who would nearly have us go toward a full lockdown compared with those constituents who recognise that this current situation and our approach to it's not sustainable, namely businesses, and it is having a very serious and significant impact on their livelihoods, which again has its own public health consequences. So it can't be a competition. It has to be a balance between what we both need to do. But what was so apparent to me is that, and I agree with comments that John had made, people were prepared to do what was right. However, they needed to know what that right is. And I think the difficulty for many businesses was the length of time that it took for the executive to make a decision. And I'm not here to rehearse what happened last week. But I do think if there was any point that we were trying to put on to the executive, it would be to almost create an options paper so that we're not in a situation where there's wrangling going on. There's a case of, you know, these are the various options that I need to do, and then make a decision on it in good time. Because, you know, we all know that particularly for hospitality, they're ordering in fresh produce, they're ordering in their various alcohols and beverages and drinks and all of that. And that's a significant waste of money. So not only are they losing money from profit and from sales and services, but they're also losing money from the produce which they're trying to bring in. And, you know, people are saying, look, if we have to close, we can close. Just give us enough time to do that. So I think if there was a message we're going to put on to the executive, it is to do that. And the other message, and I know I sound like a broken record on this, communications is key to all of this. You know, you dispel fear and uncertainty by communicating better. And we're at a point now where people are so confused by the restrictions. They don't know if the restrictions in August are still applying. They don't know if the restrictions from 16th of October are applying. They don't know if they're able to open or close, because it's so ambiguous. And my kind of point of reference is always the regulations, but the regulations are really difficult to read when you have to cross-reference them over 20 amendments. You know, so I think, you know, if there was a message that I would hope this committee could take back to the executive, it would be to make your decisions quicker in good time so that businesses can actually plan and prepare, and also communicate your decisions effectively, because that is what I'm hearing on the ground. And I think that's where the biggest issues are. So thank you, Chair.
Thank you, Claire. And just to bring this item to a close before we move to a briefing from NICVA, I think all of us agree that we would like to have the economy open, and we need to do that in the safest way. But there are other things in terms of the health system that need to be there to support that, in terms of the test, trace and isolate system. And that also needs attention, obviously. That's a matter for the health committee, but these two things are very much interlinked. And I think, just, you know, obviously those figures are stark, but as John has highlighted, we do need to take everything in the round as well. Peter, there's nothing additional in relation to that.
No, Chair. And our NICVA witnesses are now appearing on our screen. Okay. So if members are content, we'll move to item five for them.
Okay, so we're moving to item number five then, members. And if we could bring Seamus and Jeff into the spotlight, please.
I'm telling a lie there. It's not item five, it's item 15, sorry.
Sorry, Ashley, members, it's item number 15 on your agenda. And at 15.1, there is a clerk memo at page 307 of your pack. There is NICVA presentation slides on EU funding at page 134 of your table pack. There is a statement in relation to the 21st meeting of the North-South Ministerial Council on the SEUPB sectoral format at page 143 of your table pack. And last week at our committee, we considered correspondence from the department in relation to ESF project promoters in relation to funding for priority 1 and 2 beneficiaries supported by the European Social Fund, which is due to end in March 2022. The committee has written to the Minister to seek details on where current EU funding sources stand and when they're expected to end. And today's briefing will allow us to hear from NICVA on the European Social Fund programme, as well as any discussion that they're aware of regarding the success of funding the Shared Prosperity Fund. So I'd like to welcome to our meeting this morning Seamus McAleady, who is Chief Executive of NICVA, and Jeff Nuttall, who is Head of Policy and Public Affairs at NICVA. So I hand over to yourselves to make an opening statement, and then we will invite members to ask any questions that they have.
Thank you very much, Chair, and thank you for the invitation to come along today and present on EU funding. A few brief words from me, and then Jeff is going to take you through a presentation, which I think you also have in your pack, you know. In terms of when an EU funding period comes to an end and another begins over the year, it's quite a difficult time in that they're very complex negotiations. And one of the things that we have found over the years is they go on for quite a long time, generally always longer than is expected, which causes anxiety for those who are involved in the delivery of programmes. It's much worse this time now that the UK has left the EU, and the UK has proposed to put in place, you know, other funds, you know, to make up for some of the EU funds, although obviously we still be involved in Peace Plus and Interreg in the next mandate. But with regard to the Sustainable Prosperity Fund, this has been for us one of the longest running non-consultations ever, in that I spoke with the Prime Minister Theresa May back in November 2018 about this and asked her directly when the consultation would begin, and she confirmed before Christmas that didn't happen. I talked to her again in February of the following year, and again the consultation was promised to start very soon and that didn't happen, and it really hasn't happened since. Talked to Brandon Lewis several times about it, and it looks as if the issue is still locked very much in Whitehall. So organisations here not being consulted with, not really knowing what's going on. As I say, it increases the anxiety with regard to what the follow-on might be. So I think there's a lot of extra difficulty, and we'll be happy to take questions on that after Jeff carries out his presentation, which will cover all the ground with regard to these funds. So if I could pass over to Jeff.
Okay. So I'm going to try and share my screen here, and hopefully you'll be able to see. Can I just check? Can everyone see?
Yeah.
Okay, so really just wanted to give you a flavour, just building on what Seamus has said, of the importance of EU funding for the sector, and some of the concerns that the sector's been raising, and you know, what we think, you know, some of the potential gaps might be. So this fairly busy slide really just gives an overview of the importance of EU funding for voluntary community organisations. And from our rolling programme, State of the Sector, our research programme, which looks regularly at the income the sector receives, we looked at European funding, and the most recent figures were that around about 17.7 million per annum is received by the sector. But we know that that's a significant underestimate, because there are quite a few programs where it's very difficult to extract the amount, the proportion that goes to voluntary community organizations as opposed to public and private. So we know that that's definitely a significant underestimate. And I think we'd always say that what's important is not just the quantum of money, but what it funds and how it targets needs. So all of these European programs, European Social Fund and others, are part of European-wide strategies to target particular needs. And there's really four key programs that are of particular importance: the Rural Development Programme, meeting the needs of rural communities, and also environmental work. European Social Fund, include for the inclusion of vulnerable groups into the labour market. Interreg, for the needs of border communities and cross-border collaboration right across the board, be it in health, environmental, or tourism cooperation. And then Peace, the Peace 4 programme most recently for peace and reconciliation. Just wanted to say that those are not the only programmes, and there are a number of other key European programmes that are also, their future is either not good or uncertain, but just to highlight a number in particular: the Erasmus Education Training and Youth Work Exchange Programme, which, just to give you an example, brought 28 million to Northern Ireland in 2017, is an important source, and the future of it is completely uncertain. There's an example just on the right there of a project that supported over 300 volunteers through the European Voluntary Service, and also the European Solidarity Corps, which the UK government said it won't continue with, brought €800,000 into Northern Ireland organisations, voluntary community organisations, in 2020. And there are others like Life Plus, which is an environmental programme, Horizon 2020 for research. I think the key concerns of the sector, the lack of clarity, as Seamus said, the incompleteness of plans to replace EU funding programmes, and in particular the UK Shared Prosperity Fund, which, as Seamus said, there's been no public consultation, really, after 3 years of waiting. The focus is unclear, a lot of talk about it focusing on the UK industrial strategy, but not really knowing or having detail on what that means yet. And also the delivery mechanisms. And I think a key issue is the uncertainty as to whether it will be devolved in the way that your previous programs that it's replacing will be, or will it be a centrally controlled competitive fund, more like city deals? And again, there's a lot of anxiety around that. And time is really running out, because in the past, European programs, which run for 6 years, have taken a very long lead-in period to develop. So we are really running out of time to develop something substantial to replace them. In particular, on the European Social Fund, it's a fund that's benefited over 77,000 people in Northern Ireland to integrate for social and economic integration. And just to give an example of one organisation in our sector, Action Mental Health, it's through the programme currently, it's on track to support 2,450 very vulnerable people furthest from the labour market, and a number of the organisations that receive European Social Fund that we support developed a paper calling for transitional funding through the current mechanisms to allow time to develop a replacement. And there's a lot of concern that, as I say, we're running out of time to develop, and there may be a hiatus between the current programme and something that replaces it. On the Peace Plus programme, which will replace the Peace programme and Interreg, I think we've carried out a large consultation, and there's a link to our response. I think a key concern there is to make sure that it genuinely is still a special program for peace and reconciliation in 2020 and doesn't become something which becomes a top-up to mainstream government budgets, especially at a time when we know budgets are under pressure. So just to kind of summarise the kind of key gaps that we see potentially opening up here post-Brexit, the uncertainty over whether the UK Shared Prosperity Fund will genuinely fill the gaps previously filled by the European Social Fund and the Rural Development Programme, whether Peace Plus will be able to meet all the needs for peace building and cross-border collaboration, given the pressures, and then the known losses like the European Solidarity Corps for volunteering, which we know at the moment is not going to be continued, and then a range of other programmes that, like Erasmus, that we're still uncertain. And I think in the current UK-EU negotiations, there is no sense that we're going to get answers to that or that they would form part of a deal if one is done before the end of the year. Finally, just to say that this is happening against the backdrop of the COVID-19 crisis, and just to say that we've just completed the seventh COVID impact survey on the sector, and it's shown pretty stark impacts on the loss of income for organisations already. So 2/3 of organisations that we surveyed have lost services, and those services will affect thousands of beneficiaries in turn. More than 1 in 10 have already made staff redundant, and nearly 1 in 10 are saying that they think their organisation may not survive. So it's a stark background to this, and I think it reinforces the need that the crisis funding that's been received is very welcome, but I think the strong message is longer-term strategic funding is what's needed. Previously, European long-term programmes have provided one form of that, and obviously they're leaving a funding and a policy gap. So I think the big message we'd want to leave with you is the need for a strategic long-term support to meet those needs that European funds have previously met. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that overview and for the additional information there in relation to the impact of COVID on the sector. That is useful for us to have as well. I guess my first question to you was going to be, had you any more information on the European Social Fund or the Shared Prosperity Fund than we do? But I guess that is an area that has been a considerable concern for us, and we've been highlighting for quite some time with all of the relevant Westminster committees and ministers as well. And obviously we're getting to near the end point here in terms of the negotiations, and the lack of clarity in respect of that is concerning. I know it's something the Finance Minister has a particular focus on as well. I just have a couple of questions then. In relation to the European Social Fund specifically, has there been a commitment to match that pot of funding from the British government, not just as overall within the Shared Prosperity Fund? And in relation to the point that you made about the transitional funding, has there been any feedback or response to that?
Okay, I think maybe if I answer. So the first point, if I understand correctly, you're asking, has there been a commitment to meet the same level of funding as ESF previously? No. There certainly have been statements by UK government generally about that European funds overall should meet the same previous levels, but there's no detail on any of that. And so I think there's still a big degree of uncertainty. The second point, if you can just, sorry, could you just remind me of
the transitional funding piece that you mentioned, has there been any feedback or response to that?
Well, certainly the ESF users group that NICVA supports, it's around about sort of 50 or so organisations. We developed a paper, wrote to the economy minister, and have been engaging with the department officials and highlighting the need for a transitional programme. I mean, to date, there hasn't been a commitment to that. But we're in kind of fairly constant dialogue on the issue at the moment. But as I say, there's a lot of concern amongst organizations delivering services that, you know, the longer we wait without any clarity on whether there's a transition and when the new program will be available, I think the anxiety is growing.
Thank you for that. I'm going to hand over to some other members for questions.
Stuart,
you're first.
Yeah, sure. Thank you. And again, my questions are really, they're all, all the questions this morning are going to be in the similar area about how you deal with the uncertainty around the Shared Prosperity Fund, what the prospects are for, if that fund is made clear to us by the end of the year, how it could possibly be rolled out. But the other question I want to ask is, all of the various European funding streams that come into Northern Ireland, do they all end at the same time, or is there a timeline that runs through those so that we can sort of work our way through how they can be replaced and at what stages they're coming to an end?
Well, generally, they come in 6-year cycles. So the structural funds programs, the rural development program, the European Social Fund, Peace and Interreg, are on those 6-year cycles, and so they are all essentially coming to an end at a similar time. There's usually a spend up period of 2 to 3 years after the end of the program commitment period. So some of them are happening at the same time. So Peace Plus is looking to be a replacement for Peace and Interreg, but the UK Shared Prosperity Fund is intended to replace ESF and the Rural Development Programme, who are on the same cycle. The other ones I mentioned, like Erasmus, European Solidarity Corps, much less certain. We could be in a position like countries like Norway that make a decision to buy into these. And given that they're not being given a priority at the moment, there's no time scale for that. It's outside the negotiations. So I think with the structural funds, there is a cycle. There's concern that UK Shared Prosperity Fund may be falling behind that cycle. I think Peace Plus is probably the only one that is trying to be in place in time to pick up from that cycle. Hopefully that answers your question.
If I could pick up maybe on the shared prosperity one, because it's causing clearly the most confusion and anxiety. And as I say, when we talk to our colleagues in England and Scotland and Wales, they have little information either. Although there are some rumours that there might be an announcement on the fund next week. 25th of November was mentioned, and no consultation. So we don't actually know what the government will commit it to fund. That's the first point. The second bit is that in the internal market bill, you know, it's our understanding that government centrally could take control and could deliver a fund like this, whereas the activities that are carried out under ESF are certainly matters that are normally devolved. You know, they're devolved issues, but it looks as if the government could deliver this centrally. So there's two issues there. And I put that to the Secretary of State, Brandon Lewis, asked him about it, and asked him when there'd be a consultation, asked him when things would begin to roll out. And he thought, he didn't know about consultation, but he certainly thought that Shared Prosperity Fund would be, as he described, feathered in. So it would begin to start to spend, he reckoned, springtime of next year. But again, we're not quite sure what any of that means.
The two areas that there's particular concern around, both Erasmus and the European Solidarity Corps, which we know there's very clear signals will not be continued. If it's possible for the UK to buy into those, as you've suggested other non-EU states do, there's clearly going to be a gap between the end of those projects now and any campaign to either, because we've no idea whether the government is interested in them, let alone whether they're prepared to buy in, and there'll have to be negotiation over the price and all of that. There will be a massive deficit in the people who would normally and naturally have flowed through that. I think that's a major area for concern.
If I could just come in on that, Seamus. I mean, I think we would agree that there is a real danger of a gap, and I think the problem with a gap in those programs and others is organizations are, many of them are geared up to deliver these types of activities, and if there's a significant break, their ability for those organizations to keep doing that is severely hampered as well. They are delivered through their own staff and volunteers as well. So the ability to be able to continue to take forward those sorts of activities is also impaired, so that even it isn't always a case of just picking up where they left off.
Yeah, I think it is. A gap like this really promotes inefficiency and ineffectiveness. When you bring a program to an abrupt halt, introduce a new one sometime later, organizations have, moved on. Sometimes they've had to make people redundant and things like that. And then they may be asked to start something very similar. So it just promotes inefficiency, ineffectiveness, and is a complete waste at times of good public resources.
Chair, just finally, in respect of both of those programs, the people who participate in them generally tend to be at a particular stage in their education or their development or their career path. And there's going to be a group of people who will simply not have had that experience, because you can't go back into that experience. Thank you, Chair.
Yeah, we agree.
I know.
Thanks, Stuart. Can I just ask, in relation to particularly Erasmus, but also Horizon and things like that, has there been conversations between yourselves and the Irish government? Is something that we have consistently raised with them about the potential for support coming from them for those projects through the Good Friday Implementation Committee?
Maybe I could just come in. I suppose the short answer is I'm not aware of a lot of conversations in that area. One area I know some organisations have been investigating with the Irish government is the continuation of the European Solidarity Corps through the Irish government. But all I can really say is that's an idea that's been raised. On the other programmes, I couldn't comment.
John
O'Dowd,
bring John into the spotlight, please.
Thank you, Chair, and thank you, Seamus and Jeff. Given that the trade talks are coming to a conclusion one way or the other in the next number of days, and we're all experienced observers of negotiation in this part of the world, and things can take twists and turns. Well, in terms of the macro politics, if those trade talks are unsuccessful, where does this leave this European funding?
I think that it leaves the whole thing in quite a lot of difficulty, and especially if those trade talks break down and there's a lot of animosity. I think that at the very least, John, we'd be looking at delay while more negotiation takes place, and all of that. So I suppose from our point of view, it can only muddy the waters even more with regard to some of these programs. You take Peace Plus, but at least we think there's an absolutely full-on commitment from the European Union, from the United Kingdom government and the government of Ireland. So, that's probably fine, but you would wonder, you would worry about other things.
And if it doesn't come to fruition, Seamus, what sort of scenario are we looking at in terms of job losses, scheme losses, investment loss?
Well, Jeff pointed out some of the numbers there that are involved, the amounts of money and the delivery of programs. The delivery of ESF programs, significant number of people's people employed in organizations like Action Mental Health and organizations like that, delivery of services to people with educational needs, mental health issues, people with disabilities, and those who are furthest away from the labour market. It does leave the Northern Ireland Executive with a big public policy issue that it has to address, however it might fund that. And if shared prosperity fund is not clear and is not moving into that realm, then we would have a real problem. And a lot of, certainly our organisations, as you know, we don't operate with huge surpluses. We quite often do not operate with big reserves. So the impact is always immediate. You know, we very, very quickly find organisations having to make people redundant, cut down their capacity and try and survive as an organisation. So very detrimental, potentially.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks, John. Gordon?
Thanks, Sharon. Good to see you again, Seamus and Jeff. You mentioned about community groups, and I think we're all very familiar with community groups that are active within our own constituencies. Do you see them suffering heavily from the loss of funding? And is there a major gap that will appear because of what is proposed in relation to the groups that operate and have been there now for many years, actively within our own communities?
Good to see you as well, Gordon. And our sector, when you look across all the different types of organisations, they're all funded in many, many different ways.
Yeah.
And in terms of the impact of COVID, you found that those organisations that have fundraised quite a lot from the public, they have been hit really hard. A lot of those fundraising activities have stopped. There's been significant support in terms of grant support and contract support from government departments and other agencies, and that has been very welcome in making the need. But there's little doubt that there's huge pressure on voluntary and community organisations, and that's what our surveys show. There are a few that are doing very well in the circumstances. So every piece in the jigsaw, like this, the one we're discussing now, has an even bigger impact when you consider all the other problems that are there as well. And as I say, when we reflect on past changeovers of programs, they've always been difficult, they've always taken more time, but now we're even in a much more complex arena. So the potential for damage is great. And I suppose what we hope is that there's agreement next week in terms of trade, and we hope that there's a follow-on agreement on all these other issues, and that we can get some sort of stability as we start to head towards the new year.
Local government obviously have had a key role in supporting a lot of these groups, but they're not in a good position at the moment. I suppose that's another risk and a concern. Unfortunately, a lot of them are deficit building up because of restrictions with COVID and the lack of income. So that's probably a risk too as well that needs to be identified and addressed.
I mean, that is definitely the case. I mean, a lot of income sources, as you say, in local government has stopped, footfall stopped, activities have stopped. And it's the same for a lot of voluntary organisations as well, particularly those involved in social enterprise. Those activities stopped, and therefore it's another source of income that goes. Department for Communities has provided additional assistance to councils, and particularly in the area of support to community organisations, and that's helpful. But there's no doubt, all around this is a very difficult situation.
Yeah. The Rural Development Programme, I had the joy of serving on some of the partnerships, and no doubt they've done a lot of good work. And again, DERA are involved. What about continuing these programmes with support from DERA? Is that a likelihood? But obviously they need a partnership arrangement, and that's probably where the gap still needs to be addressed.
Jeff?
Yeah, if I can maybe come in. I mean, I think there is a lot of thinking which needs to be done to replace the space that the Rural Development Programme fills, because it really cuts across rural community activity, environmental activity, supporting, you know, businesses, the rural economy.
Yeah, business support,
Yes, so, you know, along with programs like LEADER as well. There's a whole architecture of European programs looking at, you know, right across the kind of rural society, economy and environment. As we said before, these programs, as you'll know, take a long time to design, negotiate, and then put in place. And there's a whole strategy behind them. So, you know, obviously it'll fall to DERA to pick up those conversations with rural business, agriculture, rural communities, and also environmental organizations. And I know they are doing that. But again, with the uncertainty around the UK Shared Prosperity Fund and the actual money that's going to be available, I think it's quite pressurized.
Okay, thanks very much, gentlemen. Thanks, Chair.
Thank you, Gordon. Thank you very much for your presentation this morning. It has been useful to us, and we will be continuing to put whatever pressure we can on to get further information and obviously be keeping an eye to any potential further details that come out over the next week. That date was
25th.
News to us.
I hadn't heard that one before.
Yeah. Okay.
Thank you, Nate.
Thanks again.
Thank you, Chair. Thanks to the committee. Cheers.
Thank you.
Bye now.
Okay, members, we are going back to matters arising. We had got to
4.7, yep.
So at page 92 of your pack, there's advice and guidance from the department in relation to coronavirus advice for students in higher education. And then at 4.8, at page 98 of your pack, there's advice and guidance in relation to students in further education. Obviously, we have discussed this at length in our previous item, so we'll be taking the same action in relation to these points. 4.9 then, at page 101 of your packs, there's a clerk's memo from the PAC to the clerk of the committee in relation to the acknowledgement of the committee's intention to set aside in the interest of primacy to the NI Audit Office report. PAC will undertake to keep the committee appraised of progress on the inquiry and the likely publication date of the PAC's report. So that's to note, unless members have any additional comments.
Great.
If members can still hear.
Sorry about that.
So 4.10 then, at page 103 of your pack, there's a response from UK Finance and I Committee in regards to business accounts. The committee had agreed to correspond with the Finance NI Committee in relation to opening of new business accounts, which the committee had noted are required for applicants to be able to avail of some of the COVID-19 related supports from the from the British government. The latest figures from the British Business Bank show that 33,645 businesses in the north have been offered over $1 billion of support through the Bounce Back Loan Scheme up until the 15th of October. Some banks have decided to focus on processing outstanding applications through the UK government scheme and or to prioritise the needs of existing customers. To do so, certain information is required for identification and to comply with the anti-fraud measures. It's estimated that these industry controls have stopped over 27,000 potentially fraudulent applications for over $1 billion of support to date. Recent FCA guidance has highlighted the heightened risk of fraud associated with new customer applications and has asked the industry to remain vigilant in this area. This means that a number of new customers may face delays or encounter difficulties when trying to apply for a business account. Members might have some comments they want to make on this, but I was going to suggest that that we seek to get a briefing.
Sure. That's what we're working towards now that we have opened up the relationship, is do what we did with the Association of Insurers.
Yes.
And bring them in just to have, I think, rather than back and forth correspondence, it's time for discussion on a lot of these issues, and making the point that the committee has heard a lot from stakeholder groups. So you have that set of personal stories that I think it's probably what they need to hear now. So we're working towards getting a briefing on that.
page are we on? Sorry.
103.
Thank you.
Okay, so are members content with that?
Yeah, great.
Okay. Thank you.
At 4.11 then, at page 105 of your packs, is a response from the FE Principals Group in relation to COVID-19 and information collection. The response indicates the department are collating information from staff and students who report that they have tested positive from COVID-19 from the 1st of September, and FE colleges provide them with fortnightly updates. So are members content to note?
Great.
Moving on then to page 106, there's correspondence from Brian Donaldson.
Sorry,
go ahead, John.
This relation to the last piece of correspondence. If the department's collating the information, can we get the information from the department?
Yeah, absolutely. We put that in our DALA readout.
Yep.
Okay, thank you.
So page 106 of your packs, there's correspondence from Brian Donaldson, the spokesperson for excluded NI in relation to the newly self-employed scheme, the newly self-employed people who have not been able to receive support. He's highlighted to the committee that, having spoke with HMRC, that a newly self-employed person would be eligible for a scheme if they have submitted a tax return early, and stated this would give the department the proof to help develop this scheme for people and take away the risk of fraud. I think he has corresponded with the department.
He has.
Also,
he's copying us into everything he's sending to them, Chair, so the department has this.
But unless members have further comments, we obviously know that the Minister intends to bring the paper and the newly self-employed scheme to the Executive tomorrow. At 4.13, then, page 4 of your table pack, there's a response from the Minister in relation to higher education students' travel over Christmas. The Minister has stated that it's her firm view that any issues relating to travel for students, as they would be for any other members of the public, are a matter of public health. Any such advice and guidance must therefore be provided by the relevant health authorities. In the addition, the Minister has made this case both to the Minister of Health and her executive colleagues. Obviously, again, we have addressed with this issue along with the previous item, so we'll be taking that up similarly. At 4.15 then, sorry, 4.14 we've already dealt with, so 4.15, page 6 of table pack. Joint correspondence between the Minister and the Minister of Education in relation to the Transition of Young People into Careers 14 to 19 project. On the 24th of March 2020, the Ministers wrote to the committee to update them on the temporary suspension of the project due to COVID-19 and the need to redeploy staff to business critical tasks. Members will be aware that Transition of Young People into Careers project has now been reinstated, and this will have an important impact on DFE and DE strategies, including the skills strategy. So if members are content, we will seek a briefing from the department.
Great.
At 4.16 then, page 7 of table pack, there is a departmental response in relation to funding of the UU Belfast campus. At our meeting on the 30th of September, the committee received a briefing from the department on October monitoring round. Members had agreed to ask the department to provide more detail on the funding for Ulster University Belfast, focusing on the de-escalation of risk and how that will work. This obviously now falls to the PAC as part of their inquiry. So are members content to forward the response to the PAC?
Yes,
thank you.
Page 4.17 then, page 9 of table pack. Departmental response in relation to a forward request from the ERA committee on the overlap of business. At its meeting on the 14th of October, the committee considered correspondence from the ERA committee on the overlap of committee business on EU exit matters. Members agreed they would like a further update on the trader support service, the readiness of the goods vehicle movement system, and the good new movement reference, due to go live on the 1st of January. So are members content to share that update with the ERA committee?
Yep. Great.
Thank you.
4.18 then, at page 12 of table pack, there is a department response in relation to more information from InvestNI on the recent uptake of ongoing COVID-related support schemes. At its meeting on the 14th of October, the committee received a briefing from InvestNI regarding the uptake of the recently announced schemes, and members had agreed to ask for updated figures. So those are for noting, unless there's any further comments.
Thank you.
4.19 then, at page 13 of your table pack, there's a response in relation from the department in relation to assistance for travel agents. At our meeting on the 14th of October, the committee considered the response from the department regarding NIA travel agents. The committee agreed to request a further update as travel agents didn't receive assistance due to multiple premises. Have members any comments they want to make in relation to that?
Lots of businesses seem to have fallen down on that basis in terms of multiple premises. I mean, I'm sure we all have, but like I have in my constituent fella that, I don't want to name the store, but he's basically manager of like four of the set, but they're, you know, they only got the one payment. Even though they're, you know, in South Belfast, they're paying top-notch rates, you know, so it's not confined, I suppose, to the travel sector, this.
Chair, this is one, goodness, it goes right back to the beginning. We've That's been right. writing on this one since the very start. And various responses have come from various ministers, and there have been some comments recently that have suggested that it may now get another look, because it's one that hasn't really gone away, and it's causing a particular kind of hardship to what are very viable, thriving or were thriving businesses. Obviously, things are difficult at the minute, so hopefully, this is something we're going to see addressed. But the committee has put a lot of pressure on the executive.
Just related to that, in terms of consumer rights and what have you, lots of people maybe booked stuff in sort of March, April, thinking, oh, this will pass. Clearly it hasn't. Are they entitled to full refunds?
That's a very good and complex question that depends on a number of factors, including insurances, types of contracts that they've gone into. This is one that's pretty much being unpicked on a constant basis, and I think probably a couple of months ago, things started to change in that there was more of an understanding that this wasn't going to be short term, and that where people didn't need to book far in advance, that they shouldn't and wouldn't. It's one of those issues that is continuing to evolve, and you just about get a solution to one problem.
And another one emerges.
And then another bigger, slightly different one arrives on the scene. But I think generally the way this is being approached is that advanced booking of any kind is probably not a good idea until we find ourselves in a position where either there's a vaccine or we have other systems in place so that we can say, yes, we are bringing down this and we know how to
presently,
stop it spreading.
Presently, it's down to... I know people that are going to Lanzarote and stuff. So presently, it is down to personal choice.
Yes.
So the argument presumably from the company will be, well, look, you're making the personal choice not to go. And yeah, okay. No, that's fair enough.
Here, I think the last paragraph there is a good summary. Just had time there to read it, and you can see that there is still a push on to try and get them some funding.
Yeah.
The First and Deputy First Minister have been involved, they've met with representatives, and they've recognised that they've been severely hit. When you think about it, travel has been so restricted, it's bound to have had a huge impact on them. The multi-site thing has rattled on, as you say, Peter, since we started this.
It has, yeah.
You know, and a lot of us have a lot of sympathy for it, but it never seems to have really got off the grid very well, and there are other
ones, but I think
they keep mentioning that rates is an issue. You know, they've already got rate support. The furlough scheme has been there for staff and so on and so forth. I understand there was a judicial review taken which was dismissed by a number of the larger retailers, which to me is unfortunate, but that's where we are. But I do see some hope here in this last paragraph, so we'll just keep the pressure on, and we'll keep trying to influence those that we are in contact with to make sure that the issue is addressed.
Chair, the Minister has talked this week in some of the responses she's given at various points in the Chamber about revisiting previous schemes with the reflecting on the fact that there's now a new pot of funding available, that the Executive is going to revisit things they've done before, where it worked, where there are gaps. I suppose now we've had a length of time where a gapping and mapping exercise can be done. So I don't want to create another false dawn, because I think I've probably done that before. But there is more talk now about filling those gaps. So I think if we look at what's likely to be announced in the next couple of weeks. Hopefully that will start to address those issues and those raised by excluded NI.
Yeah. Okay, thank you, Peter. So move on then to 420 at page 16 of your table pack. There's a response from the Minister for Finance in relation to impact of COVID-19 restrictions and extended coronavirus job retention scheme. So that's to note unless members have any additional. 421 then at page 19 of the table pack, there is correspondence from the Minister for Communities in relation to the impact of COVID-19 restrictions on students living in HMOs. At our meeting on the 21st of October, the committee agreed to write to the Communities Minister to highlight issues around houses of multiple occupancy. The Minister has indicated that it's outside the scope of her department to intervene where there are contracts and assistance may be sought from Belfast City Council. So that's to note also, ask members of any additional comments. So moving on then to 422, at page 21 of the table pack, there's correspondence from the British Retail Consortium in relation to Trouble with Borders, the NI Retail Consortium article. So it's just for members to note, they've probably already seen it.
Yeah.
And then at 423, page 24 of the table pack, there's correspondence from LAMP in relation to requesting to brief the committee. So we have dealt with that.
Yeah, Chair, what I would suggest is that the committee wait to see now what the department is doing before they go anywhere else.
Okay. Members content?
Mm. Thank you.
At 424 then, page 25 of the table pack, correspondence from Ulster University in regards to a number of COVID-19 cases and how information is collected. The response indicates that UU has established the Ulster University Incident Management Team to carry out the duty of contact tracing and collection of data. So that's similar, I suppose, to what Queen's have been doing.
So yeah.
Are members content to note?
Yes.
Great.
Thank you.
Okay. So moving on then to item number 5, where 3 are matters arising now. There is a departmental briefing on Project Stratum, page 108 of your pack, the Minister's update on Project Stratum, that the members will now be aware the corporate governance and internal approval process have been complete and the contract has been issued for award, and the department will be respecting so the contract has now been announced to Fibrous Networks Limited, and we have received just last night an embargo briefing paper. So members have any points they want to make on that? Obviously very welcome to have this contract finally announced, very important project to have rolled out, and particularly for our rural communities that for a very long time have faced deficits in terms of broadband access. And obviously Project Stratum, I think something like 79,000 premises will be connected, and 97% of those are classified as rural. So it will be transformational for many rural communities, and I hope my postcode is included. But
figures look impressive, Chair.
Yeah. Gary, you wanted to come in?
No, it was just to echo those words, Chair. Obviously, it's very, very welcome news, particularly for our rural communities. My own constituency, over 3,500 properties should benefit from this scheme, so I think that'd be very welcome. COVID-19 has no doubt created a greater emphasis for the need for full and effective broadband. It shouldn't be a luxury in Northern Ireland. You know, everyone should have access to full and high-speed broadband is something that's very much welcome. It would be remiss of me not to obviously recognise the fact that, you know, £150 million of that came from the Confidence and Supply Agreement. And I think that we acknowledge this as well.
Go ahead, Gordon.
Thanks, Chair. Yeah, I would endorse what has been said. A couple of things. It's obviously very welcome, and I wonder, will it affect this building? Perhaps we'll get a bit of an open. We are quite rural here at the edge of my constituency.
Yeah.
You see, if you travel a mile up the Craigantlet Hills, your phone will drop out, and people, small businesses up there suffer as well. But we do welcome the investment. A couple of things. It's a big project. I think we should get a regular update on it, on the progress. We did have a bit of a briefing initially. We didn't get an awful lot of information because the contract was out at the time.
Yeah.
To me, I understand it was like a design and build type contract. It was up to them to come up with the with the requirements. So I would worry about risk in relation to it and how it's going to be managed. There's been a poor history about managing this type of project before. I'm talking about a previous programme before my time, but it used to be talked about in the early stages. I forget the name of it, but it's important that it is properly managed and held, everyone is held to account. And another thing I would like is a contact for us MLAs to get progress, to ask questions for on behalf of constituents. I think it's important we get that. Peter, if you could organise that, please.
Do that, Chair.
With, obviously with the department or even with the contractor would be useful. But it's going to be a big issue, and we, you know, realise how important this is, already been said, and, you know, everyone should have the right to a reasonable service. And we get it even within our constituency. It's a variation. It varies so much, the level of service. There seems to be disputes about who can get it and who can, and it's, you know, I think that needs to be addressed and levelled out. So we look forward to that. But I think regular briefings on how the whole project manage, I think, is also important, Chair.
Thanks for that, Gordon. And yeah, I agree that we should get those regular briefings. I think one of the things that I thought was quite positive about the way it is supposed to be rolling out is that they have done that pre-work and that they intend to begin to roll out infrastructure immediately, and there is going to be, I think it's over 6,500 premises within 6 months.
It looks very organised. That's it. The paper that members got is very hopeful. It does kind of create a warm feeling. And
yeah, it would maybe be useful to get a list of the postcodes that are intended to be delivered first.
I think the postcodes were listed in the...
There was...
the grey and the white.
The thing. But it might be, if we can get a written narrative on that, it might be...
Sure, there's also... not wishing to rain on their parade, but listening to Radio Ulster this morning, there is an interactive postcode checker for people to see where they're at. But when some people were checking it today, it said you're 3 years away from service.
I'm hoping that's just not been updated well.
It's what went live this morning.
I noticed in the papers it does suggest that's the ultimate kind of time envelope. And I suppose that's the other thing would be useful to get in an update, is more detail on how the rollout will happen, you know, the time scales, the areas and so on. So if we look to get that, I think as well, that would be much more useful, so that again, as Mr. Dunn has said, you're in a position to be able to say to constituents and so on, you're in this time slot, we expect things to be rolling your way at this point.
I mean, in terms of, like, those gaps will be filled a lot quicker than natural gas gaps will. Do you know what I mean? In terms of just getting the network spread out and stuff like that.
It's instantaneous, I think, as well. That's the other thing that people will notice. Once it's there, they will notice a lot more quickly. But if we aim to get a regular update and we try and get more information around time scaling the rollout with a bit more detail on the areas as they will be taken. At the minute, it gives us the full picture, but it's trying to break it down into a timeline more. We look for that.
Good. Okay.
John O'Dowd, do you want to come in?
Yeah, I just, in terms of Gordon and your own points about monitoring the delivery of this project, it's obviously a very good news story, and it'll be hugely welcomed by those rural communities who have been left behind with having no broadband. But experience tells us that large infrastructure projects like this have a habit of running into difficulties and sometimes can run over cost. So I would be keen to know if there is a cost overrun, who's footing that bill? Is it the taxpayer or is it the company? I have expressed concerns in the past that while this is welcome, we're paying £165 million of taxpayers' money to a private company to deliver a utility to taxpayers who then have to pay for that utility, and the people who make the profit off it are the private company. So it's a business case that to a certain degree doesn't benefit the public push in the long term. It certainly benefits people who are getting broadband, and you can't argue against that, but it is a significant amount of public investment with no return to the public purse on it.
Thank you. So if we organise those...
We will do, Chair. We keep a close check on that.
So moving on then, item number six, there's a departmental written briefing, consideration of responses to the DfE consultation on legislation to transpose the EU Gas Directive Amendment 2019-692 and related legislative changes. At page 28 of your table pack, there is the DfE consultation paper on the transposition of Gas Directive. Page 64 of the table pack, there is an SL1 submission for the transposition of Gas Directive. Just to advise members, the department proposals would make a number of amendments to the Gas NI Order 1996, the Energy NI Order 2003, and the Energy Act 2008 in order to transpose, where necessary, the requirements of the 2019 Gas Directive Amendment, which mainly relate to arrangements for gas pipelines which connect with a third country outside the European Union, provide legislative clarity on arrangements for regulating a gas storage facility sited in the territorial seas adjacent to the north, and organising third-party access in compliance with Gas Directive requirements, and make any necessary consequential amendments to the NI energy legislation, which will be effective from the end of the transition period on the 31st of December 2020. These legislative changes are largely technical in nature and are not anticipated to have any significant immediate impacts. Here, the regulations listed in SL1 at page 64 are subject to negative resolution procedure before the Assembly. So prior to receiving any analysis of consultation responses, unless there are any, so it's to note, sorry for now, prior to receiving any analysis of consultation responses, unless there's any comments that members want to make.
Noted.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Item number seven then is SR 2020-251, the Posted Workers Agency Workers Northern Ireland Order 2020. There is a clerk's memo at page 111, and the SR 2020-251, the Posted Workers Agency Workers Order Northern Ireland 2020, at page 113. At page 124, there is the Directive EU 2018-957 of the European Parliament and Council of Europe, and at page 133, the Directive 9671-EC of the European Parliament. The related SL1 was agreed by the committee on the 11th of November, and there have been no policy changes since then. The purpose of this SR is to transpose amendments to the EU Posting of Workers Directive. Here, the directive establishes the employment rights and protections that apply to a worker when they are posted as and sent temporarily to another member state of the European Union. The hirer of an agency worker will have to inform the agency if the worker is sent to work in an EU state. This SR is required to ensure that legislation here is compliant with EU law during the transition period as required under the terms of the withdrawal agreement. The rule came into operation on the 13th of November, breaking the 21-day rule. Amendments in the SR will expire at the end of the implementation period on the 31st of December. So this rule is subject to negative resolution. So if members are content, I will put the question.
Yep. Right.
That the Committee for the Economy has considered SR 2020-251, the Posted Workers Agency Workers Order Northern Ireland 2020, and recommends that it be confirmed by the Assembly, subject to the Examiner of Statutory Rules report.
Agreed. Yeah.
So item number 8 then is the SL1, the Further Education Student Support Amendment, etc. EU Exit Regulations NI 2020. There is a clerk's memo at page 140 of your packs, and there is correspondence from the DALO at page 141. The department proposes to make this amended statutory rule under powers conferred on it by Article 3, 1, 3, 2 and 8, 4 of the Education Student Support NI Order 1998. The SR contains amendments to the principal Further Education Support Student Support Regulations, the Further Education Student Support Eligibility Regulations NI 2012. It continues the status quo for students taking designated further education courses after the conclusion of the implementation period. The SR will be subject to negative resolution procedure before the Assembly. This is the committee's opportunity to consider the policy laid out in the SL1, as it's not possible to amend once the rule has been laid in the Assembly Business Office. So are members content with the policy direction? Is there anything?
No, Chair, it really is. It's just another one of those continuity beyond the end of the transition period, so that existing systems that are already there will continue to operate.
Okay. So are members content?
Great,
yes.
Item number 9 then, the Education Student Fees and Support Amendment Northern Ireland EU Exit Regulations 2020. There's a clerk's memo at page 146 and correspondence from the department at page 147. The department proposes to make this statutory rule under powers conferred in it by Articles 3 and 8, 4 of the Education Student Support NI Order 1998 and Articles 4, 8 and 14, 4 of the Higher Education NI Order 2005. This SR contains technical amendments to the Principal Student Support Regulations, the Education Student Support No. 2 Regulations, NI 2009, and the regulations which set out the persons and higher education courses eligible for home tuition fees charges in the North, student fees qualifying courses and persons regulations, NI 2007, and it continues the status quo for students taking designated higher education courses after the conclusion of the implementation period. The SR will be subject to negative resolution procedure before the Assembly. This is the committee's opportunity to consider the policy laid out in the SL1, as it's not possible to amend once the rule has been laid in the Assembly Business Office. So are members content again with the policy direction?
Great.
Thank you, Chair.
So moving on then to item number 10, SL1 transposition of the EU Electricity Recast Directive 2019. There's a clerk's memo at page 82 of your table pack, and there's correspondence on the SL1 from the department at page 84 of your table pack. Refer members to the government response to the Electricity Directive Consultation Annex A at page 87 of table pack, and to correspondence from the department at page 103 of the table pack. Now, I'm just opening it for myself here.
Great.
The department proposes to make this statutory rule under powers conferred by Section 2(2) of the European Communities Act 1972, C68. This statutory rule will transpose the Electricity Recast Directive 1 EU 2019-944, the Directive on the Internal Market for Electricity, which applies from the 1st of January 2021. The aim of the directive is to outline rules for the generation, transmission, distribution, supply and storage of electricity, together with consumer protection aspects, aiming to create integrated, completive, consumer-centred, flexible, fair and transparent electricity markets in the EU. The anticipated date that the rule will come into operation is the day after it's made. The SR will be subject to negative resolution procedure before the Assembly. This again is the committee's opportunity to consider the policy set out in the SL1, as it's not possible to amend the rule once it has been made and laid in the Assembly Business Office. Is there anything you want to add in this one?
Chair, no, this is just reminding members that we will continue to be within a single electricity and energy market, and therefore we'll continue to apply EU directives that are relevant to that. This one is one that was already there and has to be applied, but also it allows us to be able to maintain that one going forward into next year.
Okay, thank you. So moving on then to correspondence, 11.1, page 154 of your pack, there is Minister's correspondence to excluded NI regarding people who've been excluded from support. So it's for noting, unless members have any comments they want to make. So moving on then to 11.2, which is at page 156 of your pack. There is correspondence to the clerk, from the Committee of Infrastructure.
Mm-hmm.
The committee agreed to write to the Minister for the Economy regarding issues raised during the briefing from Wrightbus and Rise Hydrogen, and to forward the correspondence to the Committee for the Economy. So again, it's to note, unless there's any comments.
Aye.
So page 161 then, there's correspondence to the NI Assembly Committee for the Executive Office, response to Michael Gove MP's correspondence. The committee accepted and acknowledged that Mr. Gove was not in a position to give evidence on the work of the NI executive. However, Mr. Grove said he'd be happy to provide written evidence on issues related to the future relationship with the EU. The committee has requested written evidence from him on a number of themes. So are members content to note?
Agreed.
And to ask the TEO committee to share Mr. Grove's response?
Should be quite interesting. Okay.
11.4 then, page 165, there is correspondence from the Finance Committee regarding an update on the ongoing development process for the proposed cost programme. So it's to note for the time being, unless members have any further comments, and obviously it's applicable to our earlier discussion with NICVA.
Yeah, read.
Page 180 of your packs is correspondence from Velocity Worldwide in relation to NI digital funding. To seek members' agreement to have an informal meeting with Velocity Worldwide to aim to get a greater understanding of the proposed idea for a digital funding grant scheme.
Thank you.
Page 187 is correspondence from representatives of the Joint Committee of the Northern Ireland Community Energy and Drumlin Wind Energy Cooperative. They would like to present to the committee on the issue of community energy. So, if members are content, we'll seek an informal meeting.
Yes.
Thank you.
Page 188, there's correspondence from the Labour Relations Agency introducing the new incoming Chief Executive, Don Leeson. So, it's to note, obviously we knew Tom was...
Yeah, Tom was retiring, yeah. So, this will be effective from the 1st of December. We look for a briefing, I think, probably then, Chair.
At page 189 is correspondence from a concerned individual in relation to the house party in the Holy Land, where while COVID restrictions were in place, so it's for members to note.
Noted.
And then at page 191, it is the 28th report of the Examiner of Statutory Rules. Again, to note unless members have any comments.
Right.
Page 106 of Table Pack, then there is correspondence to the clerk. To the clerk memo in relation to the licensing registration of clubs amendment bill and asking for comments from all statutory committees. So the clerk will bring back the response.
Yeah, Chair, we have a lot of relevant stakeholders with this, so what we'll do is we'll collate views and we'll bring that back for members' agreement to respond to the Communities Committee.
Okay. And.
Page 107 then of your table pack, there is an oral statement to the Assembly by Minister Carol McEwen on the 17th of November on the Discretionary Support Self-Isolation Front. So again, it's to note unless there's any
yep.
comments. Page 110 of table pack, there's a statement from Minister Poots in relation to the 16th British Irish Council ministerial meeting. So again, just to note unless
yes,
members...
Great.
Page 115 of the table pack, there's a statement from DERA in regards to basic payment scheme simplification and the direction of travel for future agricultural policy, including support payments. So again, it's to note unless members have any comments.
Fine. I think we did all this yesterday.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we get sent a lot of these things, and it's part of our procedures that whatever we get, you get to see.
Mm-hmm.
Page 126 of your table pack, there's correspondence from an individual regarding the number of COVID-19 cases within Ulster University. So again, it's to note unless members have any comments. Page 129 of the table pack, there's correspondence from an individual regarding the number of COVID-19 cases within Queen's. So again, members content to note.
Right.
Page 131 of the table pack, there's correspondence from Brian Donaldson of Excluded NI in relation to the verification for company directors that missed out on furlough and self-employed income support scheme. So again, this has been shared with the department.
Yeah, Brian's copying us and anything he's sending to them now. So.
Grant. So page 132 of your table pack, there's correspondence from an organisation called Speed Up Britain, who campaign for better mobile connectivity in every part of Britain and the North. The organisation has requested a meeting in order to discuss details of their campaign and its importance to the rollout of 5G and improving rural and urban mobile connectivity across the North. So if members are agreed, we'll set up an informal meeting.
Yep.
Agreed.
Okay. So forward work programme then is item number 12, which is at page 204 of page 200 of your pack. So are members content?
Sure, it's still
great.
Mm-hmm. And then moving on to any other business, members probably seen the, sorry, I have the item.
You have two items, Chair, yeah.
The article on BBC News yesterday about the VAT on second-hand vehicles.
Well, second-hand vehicle, yeah.
Yeah, so currently when dealers buy a vehicle from Britain and then sell it here, they only have to pay VAT on the profits. But from January they'll have to pay VAT on the full price that they paid for the car coming from Britain, which reduces the profit margins on those vehicles or see prices rise for consumers. So for example, the VAT bill for a car bought for $8,000 and sold for $10,000 could rise from £333 to like £1,666, which is Britain is a significant source of second-hand cars coming from here, either for auctions or coming off leasing. Mm-hmm. So it's quite concerning. I think a number of second-hand car dealers have been in touch with members. From the 1st of January, we will be part of the EU scheme rather than the UK one, and the advice from HMRC states that in line with EU rules, margin schemes involving goods such as the second-hand margin scheme will not usually apply for sales in NI where the stock is purchased in Great Britain. Margin schemes will remain available for sales of goods that are purchased in NI or the EU were sold to customers in NI, Great Britain or the EU. The issue has been raised at the Joint Committee, the EU-UK body which is overseeing the NI part of the Brexit deal. So the EU would have to agree to set aside this provision of the deal if the new arrangement is not to begin in January. So
I'm sure they'll be flexible. They have been thus far.
It's one of those things where unintended consequences, I suppose, and it's been flagged up. And as you say, there's now been a fair amount of contact from second-hand car dealers who are concerned because they do buy a lot of fleet cars.
Mm. Yeah, auctions.
From GB at the auctions. You see the registrations now. Yeah. There's an awful lot of them. And it would just mean prices would go up considerably. I think at this stage we've become aware of this, but we're not 100% sure who else is aware of it. So it might be a case of flag it up to the minister, if she's aware of any kind of discussion around this, or at least even at a basic just saying, look, this is going to be an issue for a sector here. I suspect she's already hearing about it anyway. I would have thought they'd have been in touch fairly quickly with the department, but it's just getting it out there.
That's grand.
Okay, thank you. And then just the other item of business is that in relation to the support schemes. Obviously, we're expecting Part B to open today, and I'm sure members are still having significant correspondence around Part A. And I know the minister asserted in the chamber the other day that we were perhaps conflating the schemes. But I know that I can categorically state that the vast majority of the correspondence that I'm still getting is around it for those businesses without premises. And there's a number of anomalies that are coming through to me. One example is in relation to a photographer who is a photographer of newborns. So she's effectively close contact, but she has been refused the Part A scheme because she hasn't been directed to close, despite the fact that she handles newborn babies. So just what would the appeals process be there? And it's not quite clear. Another one is in relation to gymnastic instructors. So they, again, haven't been told to close, but they can't operate on a one-to-one basis. So that's unclear as to which scheme they will fit into. Are they going to be able to apply to Part A, or will Part B would be more applicable? And a further anomaly that has come to me was a hairdresser who intended to return from maternity leave this month. So she technically wasn't trading in October, and that is one of the eligibility criteria for Part A. But you would imagine that maternity would have to...
Would have been an exemption.
Would have to be a protection there.
Yeah.
But it would be useful to seek some clarity around those items.
Chair, it's what we've seen is once you operate a scheme, that's when the anomalies start to appear and the gaps and so on. So it's trying to do what the committee has been doing all along, really, I suppose, is highlighting those issues to the department and
seeking them to be closed, if you like, the gapping and mapping you talked about before. So if members are content, we'd relay issues that we're aware of in terms of, you know, the instance she raises, not going to be the only person.
Can I put one on the record then, if you could raise it for me? A self-employed insurance broker for life cover, work from an office at home, business depends on me going out to potential clients' houses to discuss their needs.
Yeah.
So that means is I can't go to anyone's house because I couldn't do any business. In fact, nothing has been done since March. It's my client base is... Sorry, I'll not read that. My client base is older than you, LOL. They don't want to take any chances.
No. So, okay, right.
So, you know, but not getting anything.
Yeah. And that's going to be a huge problem too, because I know if you've watched any level of television... The online and big companies have now stepped in and are pushing really intensive advertising during the day when older people are likely to be watching.
Mm-hmm.
For schemes it is. It's things that people used to do on a local basis. Money they used to pay to a local business, the co or whatever, is now kind of, I don't want to say it's scaremongering because that's the term that's constantly being used, but it is incredibly intensive advertising.
Yes.
And people are nervous about, well, you know, maybe I should make a reservation. If you can't get that local person, because older people generally will want
people
that
trust.
To want contact. It is, they're starting to panic. So there's all sorts of issues that I suspect you couldn't necessarily have planned for, but it's making sure that they're all flagged up to the department. So we gather all those up.
There are some of those adverts, you're absolutely right, there are some of those adverts are despicable. It's, you know, it's ease the burden on your family and all this sort of stuff, and you're some little old person.
But it's people
at home
targeting people feeling, in their 50s. It's,
feeling vulnerable, and it's not nice. It's not nice.
Well, we'll gather those up and highlight the issues to the department. Also, Chair, members are content, we look to schedule the minister come back in the next couple of weeks just to kind of update on where we are with schemes that are running, and by that stage hopefully we'll have heard additional announcements. Chair, Mr. Stalford.
Could I ask, just related to that and related to the figures that we've been given by the department, one of the things that I do think we need to establish is when these schemes, whether it's phase A or phase B, come to an end, what is the department's assessment of what the unemployment figure is actually likely to be? Because the money is not going to keep coming from London to pay for this, and I think we need to know from the department just the scale of what we're going to be facing into. When you talk about, you know, I mean, the figures that the department have given to us, 400 million for the 4 weeks, and disproportionately affecting women, the lowest paid, etc., etc. Those are very nebulous concepts. I think it would be useful for people to know that the department's assessment of, once this support comes to an end, what do they expect the unemployment figure to be? Because at the start of this, there was a figure being bandied around, I think, of 100,000.
Mm-hmm.
In addition to that, because obviously, I imagine there will be continuing modelling being done now in relation to the additional restrictions. But what is the department's intended response to these measures that have been put in place, and how slightly longer term than the support has been made available for the businesses during the restrictions, what's coming after?
If we could get those figures, that would be really helpful. And as well, what the Chair has said, the second part of that as well.
We'll look for that, Chair. Thank you.
Brilliant.
Thank you, members. So then just the final thing is the time and date of our next meeting, which is next Wednesday morning, and it's back in this room at 10 a.m. Is that right?
I think so. I just feel like something's missing.
Did I miss?
Because it's only 20 past.
Well.
It's excellent sharing.
Went through a lot.
It's excellent sharing.
Thank you.
This is the Northern Ireland Assembly Committee Room 30. This is the Northern Ireland Assembly Committee Room 30.